Hello, and welcome to another edition of UDC Forum. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Assistant Professor of History at the University of the District of Columbia, and your host. I am pleased to have as my guest former U.S. House of Representative Kendrick B. Meek. Mr. Meek returns to the nation's capital to serve as the second Ronald Walters Center Visiting Fellow. Congressman Meek's background as a U.S. House of Representative, state legislature, state trooper, and UN representative provides him with a broad perspective on a variety of public policy issues facing the nation and the world community. During this academic year, he will be working with the Ronald Walters Center staff at Howard University on projects related to race issues, police-community relations, the black vote, and policy issues that impact the African-American community. Mr. Meek, welcome back to Washington, D.C. and the campuses of the University of the District of Columbia and Howard University. Let's start with an overview of your agenda for this year.
Well, my agenda is really the agenda of the center, is to provide the students of Howard University and the greater Washington community with the opportunity to have a closer, up-close view of leadership here in Washington, D.C. Following Congressman slash Mayor Ron Dellums, chairman, in this capacity, serving at the center is a great honor for me. And it's also a great honor to be at a university in a city where the seat of government of this great country of ours resides. And students will have the opportunity to wrap their arms around that, what happens here in D.C. And it's a lot happening. Unlike any other time in the history of the country, from the White House all the way down to the City Council, the students at Howard University will have an opportunity to see themselves serve in such a capacity, seeing those that are playing out those roles of leadership within government.
The Howard University students recently had a image that was tweeted worldwide when they gathered together at the start of the academic year in support of the shooting in Ferguson. Is that the kind of activity you expect from Howard University and other students? And how are you going to be impactful to make sure that that kind of dedication and focus spreads?
Well, Doc, just like you teach a class, you teach classes and here on campus, and you are able to speak from perspective of being in the seat that your students are in. Well, I can speak from the perspective of being a former student leader on Florida A&M's campus and the issues, apartheid, and all of those things that were going on at that particular time. Jesse Jackson running for president. All of those events, I'm able to take that experience and be a part of the original thoughts of the students that are on campus. I'm excited about the leadership that they've taken, and this is not the first time. I mean, Howard University students have always been at the forefront of advocacy as student leaders, and all the way from lunch counter on to today. And the student government and the student body activity with the Ferguson issue is something that has really taken flight throughout the country of other student organizations treating it as it's their personal responsibility to provide a voice to the voiceless, not only in Ferguson, but throughout this country of ours when it comes down to injustices that take place.
We listed several things at the beginning of the program that you would be involved in. How are you prioritizing them?
Well, again, I have shared with the center's director, Dr. Elsie Scott, that I really want to give the students what they want and not what I think they should have. And that's A, making myself available to speak to an individual student or to be able to speak to a group of students. And so this week, we have activities with students and student governments. There are going to be a number of student governments coming to Howard University for a leadership academy that will take place up close, going to Capitol Hill, practicing the art of lobbying. Mm-hmm. I will serve as a former member of Congress. The things that I would look for when someone would come to my office to share their issues with me and the position they would like for me to take on a piece of legislation. This could be invaluable to, and it will be invaluable to the students and to the student leaders. It will be valuable for them to take back and share in, on their college campus. I also look forward to learning more about how young people feel about healthcare. Mm-hmm. What I'm doing now outside of Congress and after being at the UN and being in the state legislature, but I was a part of working with members of Congress to create the Health Care Act, an Affordable Health Care Act, and what some call Obamacare, to see the application of that and how it affects young people when it comes down to their well-being and how they feel about the future. Health care has always been a super-duper, very costly undertaking for Americans, and especially for those of us that come from backgrounds that have historical health issues that may be passed on from a relative or even from a loved one in some instances. Being able to afford that, to be able to understand that, is going to be a big part of their lives, which, as you know, healthcare and also infrastructure will be one of the biggest generators of our economy in the future. So I look forward to hearing some of their thoughts on that. But I'll be lecturing and I'll have small group sessions. I will make myself available, and working with the university leadership is also going to be key. We want, and I commend Howard University for the support of the Walters Center there. Ron was an outstanding advisor and a friend of mine coming up through the years. And he always set the tone for the debate through his editorials and through his speaking engagements, and would call upon some of us when we wanted him to call and when we didn't want to hear from him, and share some of the events, some of his thoughts as it relates to the topic. And so I'm excited. Who would have, like my grandmother would say, who would have thunk it that I would have the opportunity to serve in the center, really aligned with his thinking as it relates to empowering young people and keeping our society politically active in what's going on today and what will happen in the future.
There's been talk that this period of time, in terms of the Ferguson and Trayvon Martin and those other issues, are the civil rights elements for young people. Mm-hmm. What do you mm-hmm. think of that comparison?
Well, you have a social media that you did not have back when Dr. Evers was going through what she went through with her son, Megger. And I think it's good in a way, because the exposure and the connection between that period and this period is so important. There's a great education in between and at both points. And I'm familiar with Trayvon Martin's parents. They were constituents of mine in Miami, have been very active in the foundation. And so I'm glad to see that they're outside of what Dr. Evers is doing, that Sabrina has really, and I call her Sabrina because she's a friend of mine, Trayvon's mom, and Tracy, Trayvon's dad, have really been, how would I say, it's hard to put it into words, because it's been a real great opportunity for me and others who have been in a position to represent like that and understand your role in leadership. 9 times out of 10, you're taking a leadership role, but when you take a super duper leadership role and that you have to represent the masses, how do you do that? How do you position yourself? How do you educate yourself? Well, check this out. What's happening with that particular family? What's happening with Ms. Davis right now and her family? What's happening the number of countless other individuals that have been a part of injustices, injustice in the past, how do they learn? Well, it's almost like a real life experience. They learn through going through the event, the trial, nine times out of 10, a lack of justice out of that trial, visiting churches throughout the country, sitting down with elected leaders as high as the president, talking about their experience. And so how do they harness that and educate others, those of us that have not gone through that experience, on how to deal with it? And so that's what's happening. I see Dr. Evers constantly out speaking, universities, television, what have you. I see the Trayvon Martin Foundation out educating and having peaceful marches throughout the country, going to universities, you know, such as this one and others. And I think they have a very unique role in our society right now, especially as we become more and more of a melting pot, even though we have voices that are trying to prevent people from coming into the country and make it almost impossible for that to happen legally, so that we can continue to build on America, because we're strong because of our diversity. And I think that as we start to struggle with this issue on race, I hope it's not a flash in the pan. It's something that the center is very interested in, the Walters Center. And how do we continue that discussion without treating it as some sort of blue ribbon opportunity? How do we have an ongoing discussion on this particular piece of race? Because nine times out of 10, that's where we are right now when it comes down to some of the issues that have taken place, need to be in communities or dealing with law enforcement.
When you talked about the parents of Trayvon and others, and of course Dr. Eggers, people who are a 21st century grassroots leader now, as you know, a lot of times it's from the bottom up where you get the change historically, from people taking the initiative. So you now have these parents who are taking control, who certainly are grieving, but have taken that grief and formed it in such a way that they are bringing individuals, making individuals aware, talking about issues that need to be discussed. How significant is that, do you think, to young people to see these parents not so much wanting vengeance, certainly wanting justice, but being willing to go into neighborhoods, diverse neighborhoods, and talk about the need for this type of openness and understanding of diversity?
Well, education is key. Nine times out of 10, when you have people treating something, treating an event, not giving it the respect and the dignity that each event deserves. We were talking about leadership a minute ago. The human spirit will drive you to say, I should do something when this happens. Well, what do you do and how do you do it and how do you express yourselves? Having those that have gone through it able to share to the masses and without being filtered, quote unquote, by the media, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, being able to share their original unedited thoughts are very, very important, because people want to hear and they want to be led at that particular time of whatever the event may be. And the fact that we have these individuals that were everyday Americans going to work every day, trying to raise their family, find themselves in the middle of a heated debate within the country about an event that took place. Here in Washington, D.C., back when Martin Luther King was shot, I mean, this place was on fire. My barber is on H Street, and he remember walking outside of his shop and seeing cars flipped over and vehicles on fire and riot police and National Guard. It took voices then on the radio. It took even James Brown coming to town, you know, saying, listen, let's all come together. Let's calm down. This is an event. It took place in the country. unlike any other event in any recent history that anyone can remember, when Dr. King was assassinated. And you know, God would have it, now he has his place on the National Mall to be remembered and revered by future generations. But the leadership of a good, strong voice is very, very important when it comes down to how do we wrap our arms around events, how do we react to those events. And 9 times out of 10, Doc, the strongest voice is not the voice that's elected to lead, is those that are chosen to lead in those instances.
I like that last statement you made, especially when you're talking about young people, because it's so important to impress upon them that they can be leaders and giving them the tools. I like when you talked about healthcare, because many times some of the issues we want to attribute to young people aren't always necessarily issues of healthcare and sustainability and environmental issues. So you seem to be very open to allowing students to take ownership of some issues that they normally may not have been given ownership of.
9 times out of 10, they're the instigators of positive change. And the worst thing that someone such as myself that has gone through an undergraduate experience in a historical black college, on a historical black college campus, where struggling commitment and prayer and everything else wrapped around those institutions, because in our bloodline we have mothers and grandmothers that had never had the opportunity to even achieve higher education. They help promote younger generations,
right,
but they did not have that opportunity. So there's a lot of emotion that's wrapped around that. The last thing that anyone could do is stand out in front of all of that. And the reason why I kind of describe my time at the Ron Walters Institute Center, the role that I'm going to play is a role that the student body would like for me to play. How can I talk to an individual student? And I wish on Florida A&M's campus that I would have had the opportunity to cross my legs with a former congressman, former, you know, what have you, to talk about issues that I'm, you know, interested in or concerned about, or to be able to have a guest speaker. And that's the reason why I commend the leadership at Howard for taking on the center and saying that we want to provide our students with that opportunity to have that 9 times out of 10, unscheduled, unscripted conversation with someone who has walked the halls of Congress. And, you know, I just, you know, I'm very prayerful and appreciative of even having the opportunity. My mother or my grandmother or even I did not envision me at an institution of higher learning having a chance to work with young people. So when I was asked and chosen to be a part of it, I was very, very excited about it, and still am, and looking forward to the uncharted waters that I know that our young leaders will set all of us on.
You said something that's key and is very controversial now. Well, not controversial, but certainly in the spotlight of education and academia. The purpose and continued relevance of historically black colleges and universities. Mm-hmm. You talked about your time on one and the nurturing and some opportunities that there weren't there, but Howard University has the opportunity to have you there. How significant and important are historically black colleges and universities in the 21st century?
Very important, and the battle to keep them is an ongoing battle. State legislatures would like to merge them with bigger institutions, Florida A&M. There's been a discussion more than 5 times over a period of years. How do we merge Florida A&M and Florida State together to make it all one university? Of course, not named Florida A&M University, but named Florida State University. Even here in Washington, D.C., with Howard University, there have been voices and challenge to change that. I think it's a part of our country. It's a part of our history. Of course, you have these institutions that were 100% black that are now really institutions where you have international students. So in the Middle East, you have white students, you have Latino students on campus. It's an institution of higher learning. Because that access is there, There's no need to say, oh, we no longer need historical black colleges. It's a part of who we are, and it's a part of the future. And the education that one receives there, and actually I'm talking with my son now about next steps. He's on his way. He's going to graduate here in Georgetown Day School in a few months, and he's applying to colleges now. I'm proud to say that there are some historical black colleges on his list. When we went to visit universities, we actually visited universities here in the Washington area, but we also went down to Florida A&M, of course, that was the first stop. And it's on his list. We also had an opportunity to speak with President Morehouse and visit that campus. Of course, Howard University, my son has visited, and so on and on and on. But he has options that his grandmother did not have. And so I think it's important. Mom and Dad both Florida A&M and Leslie attended Fisk University. So he has his options.
Let me ask you a question. Ron, Dr. Walter's book, What Has This Got to Do with the Liberation of Black People? Love the title, love the focus of the book. Is this your mantra when you are taking up a project or an issue?
Well, you think about it, because 9 times out of 10, I always represented a seat that were majority African Americans or majority minority constituency. But when it comes down to public policy, in the Congressional Black Caucus, we would always say we're the conscience of the country. Because we're focused on real bread and butter issues that are dealing with small business, that's dealing with families, that's dealing with even this thinking that America is exposed to now, our young people, and the kind of counsel that they need to just survive as young people of color in this country. I interface with quite a few folks, you know, even outside of the visiting fellow position that I have now at the Walters Center. People say, oh, you really have to talk to your son about how to interface with law enforcement? Absolutely. Yes. Absolutely. And how do we prepare and train law enforcement to deal with my son or daughter? And so when you think about it from that perspective, I feel that there are a number of issues, even in some of Ron's writings, that's dealing with all of America and dealing with how do we understand one another. And that's one of the reasons why I'm very enthusiastic about being a part of this center, because it's important of how do we deal with one another, how do we work with one another, how do we legislate on behalf of the masses and not just for one group. How do we make sure that we have more of a level playing field than an unlevel playing field? And so I think it's very, very important, and it's a great debate. And Ron was always provoking thought, you know, when it comes down to it. Just the title alone.
Right.
I mean, we'll grab you. I've had it on my desk, you know, at the company I serve on the board of, and folks are like, whoa, what's that about? And so, I mean, that's good, because
yes,
that's what it's about. It's about calling the question, and that's what he did.
And I think one of the things, too, when we look at young people, we want them to have a wide and deep experience, but we also want them to understand the history and know that they're standing on some shoulders. Dr. Walters, of course, and others in their family who made it possible for them to get where they are. So it's important to have sort of a foundation on what does this have to do with the liberation of black people?
Mm-hmm.
Not a narrow focus, but a broad one, because
Absolutely.
It is inclusive. And
Absolutely.
I think that's you've got the right tone there. So you're excited about this position. How long will you be at the center?
I'll be there for this semester and the spring semester, which will, I guess, end sometime in July or late June. But I have an office on campus there at the center, and will be there when I leave this interview, and will be there for several weeks to come. And I'm very excited about it, and I look forward to working and taking on the challenges that are facing the debate that's going on now, not only here in Washington, D.C., but also help advising the students in the direction they should take as they approach these challenges.
One last question about the fact that we have an African-American president in the White House and some of the response to some of the things he's been trying to do. Do you think that has been discouraging to our young people who thought that maybe perhaps being president would give you an opportunity to sort of move and make some changes?
Well, they're getting a full dose of reality. I mean, there are rules that are set for presidents and leaders of the free world. And then there's rules that are set for President Barack Obama. If Hillary Rodham Clinton ends up becoming president of the United States, there'll be a set of rules for her. And so they'll have a real snapshot on what it means. Things that George W. Bush was able to get away with, President Barack Obama is not able to get away with, and vice versa. But I think it's important for us to take this moment that we're taking for granted to really pay attention to the details, what's taking place and what's not taking place. And I think that it will give them a great perspective. That's what I said from the beginning. From the president on down to the city council member, they will get a chance to see elected leadership and something that they can see themselves doing in this great country of ours.
Thank you so much for coming, and we look forward to having you back before your tenure ends to talk about your experiences.
Absolutely. I would definitely love it, and thank you. I enjoyed being on the show.
Good. If you want more information about the academic programs and events offered by the University of the District of Columbia, visit the university's website at www.udc.edu. If you would like to learn more about the Ronald W. Walters Leadership and Public Policy Center, you may visit their website at www.howard.edu/Walters Center. Thank you for watching. I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber.